Amen. Well, tonight I'm excited because tonight we're getting ready to get to word, and I'm excited because we have our own prophet Pat Fraley here tonight. Amen. So, but one of the things we were just talking about, and you all may not know it, but just recently, Prophet Catherine Sykes, who is over the ministries here at Life Center, Prophet Pat is now the director of all the prophetic ministry and teams here at the Life Center. Amen? So that's a responsibility for all of the training, and we just wish her well in this new endeavor, in this new assignment, and we're going to start by, hallelujah, receiving something tonight.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let me find my place in my Bible. I thought I had it marked. Well, while I'm looking for it, this is the third Friday of the month, and so it is Prophetic Friday. And so on Prophetic Friday, we always focus on a theme in one way or the other that relates to the prophetic. It might be training, it might be teaching, it might be whatever. And sometimes it's focusing on what God's saying now and what that means for us now. And it's kind of a little bit of a mix tonight, because let me just say this. How many of you have heard the word of the Lord for 2018? You know that this is a year of the open heaven, right? You know that double doors are open. You know that blessing has been said to be coming. You're going to get your harvest. You're going to get your blessing. There's going to be restoration. There's going to be acceleration. I mean, all those Asian words, it seems like they're all going to happen in 2018. Amen? And I believe that they can. What an open heaven does is to give us access to the fullness of all that God has for us. Amen? And my heart is to see that we get that. To get everything that we've been promised. We operate in everything that God says we can operate it in. And the odd thing is, this sounds like an opposition to what I just said. So out of that, tonight I want to talk a little bit about response to our struggles. How do we respond in crisis in this midst of this year of favor? Great favor. Have you ever heard a prophecy? I can't remember one that spoke so many things about one year and how so much favor in one year. Amen? So I want to talk about our response in this season, because do you think that favor means we never have a struggle? No. Do you think it means we never have a battle? No. Amen. In fact, probably a great example is, if you think about Joseph. Joseph was a man who received a coat of many colors. It was a coat of favor. He was his father's favorite. There's no way that that boy could hide that favoritism. I mean, everybody else got a you know, some kind of cloak. He got a colorful thing. That boy stood out. I mean, the spotlight was on him that he could not hide. And what came out of that was his brothers became extremely jealous. And you know the rest of the story about Joseph. Before he got his breakthrough and got to the end of what all God had for him, he had to go through a process that I sure am grateful that I have not had to go through. Amen? So we all know that story, so I'm not going to rehearse it. So I realize that this year especially, we have been mantled with a new cloak. You know, that coat of favor, that coat of many colors. God has put the spotlight on each and every one of us. Right? How many of you believe that? Because favor isn't just what God's going to give us. If you think about that cloak and what it represents all of the gifts he's given us already, our spiritual gifts, our talents, all of our abilities, the miracles we have in us that are still yet to come. It represents all of that. It represents the power. It represents the authority. A cloak or a mantle in the Old Testament did a lot of things. When they wore a cloak, it had purposes in the natural that really carry across into the spiritual, and one of them was, it was protection. If it was too hot, then they took it off and they made themselves a little tent. If it was too cold, then they put it on. It kept them protected from the elements, right? And a lot of them, especially those who traveled, who went about and did things, they didn't stay in one spot. Nobody nowadays stays in one spot, amen? How many of you have lived in more than one place? Amen, most of you. All right, so we're moving around. We have a lot of places we can have an impact. Those that traveled in their cloaks or their mantles, their coats, they had a belt. And in that belt, it carried food. So it carried provision. It carried food, and it carried their weapons. You know, they may have little knives or swords. I don't know what they carried, depending on who they were. But that cloak was a protection. It provided resources. It was a cloak of provision and weapons. And so our coat, if you think about the coat of favor and all that we have inside of us, all the weapons we already know we have, prayer and prophecy and, miracles and et cetera, tongues, whatever, all those weapons we have that help us to make ourselves not just to carry weapons, but to be a weapon. When we have that coat on, we put on that coat of favor this year. All of that is appropriated to us, right? It opens, the windows of heaven are already open, but it gives us access to reach through and to pull down from the heavens that which God ordained for us, amen? It's an awesome time in the Lord, amen? How many of you commit to wear that coat of favor this year and every year afterward? Well, Joseph wore his coat, and he had some battles. So we're saying, Lord, I'm going to wear that coat of favor. I'm going to stand out for you. Your light's going to shine on me, and I'm going to be seen. What that says to me when I say that and I declare it, I will be seen for you this year, Jesus. I will. You will be seen in me this year in ways you haven't been seen before. Amen? You don't think that as a spotlight shines on you, someone's not going to get jealous? You don't think someone's going to get uppity and say to you, who do you think that you are, Daryl Spearman, that you can speak the word of the Lord? You don't think that's going to happen to you? It will. Because we have an enemy, right? We have a God of the impossible who can do all things, and we have an enemy who tries to pull us away from remembering that. Amen? So I'm talking about a response to crisis or struggle in this time of favor because it is my heart to see that we do not fall back into our typical patterns when a struggle comes, because never have I heard a year prophesied like this one has been prophesied. And our typical pattern when struggle comes is we fight for a little while. The next thing we're saying things like, and maybe jokingly initially, something happens, you say, I thought this was a year of favor. And then we're saying, I thought this was a year of favor. Amen? And then we're saying things like, well, that was a prophetic word, but my life hasn't changed. This is not a year of favor for me. Amen? When we do that, we take our coat off.
That's right.
Amen? When our words and our actions line up with the enemy's plan for our life, we've taken off that coat of favor and put on a worldly coat.
That's right.
Amen? So this year, I don't know about you, but I want to keep my coat on.
Yeah.
Amen? I got a lot of coats at home. I don't wear any of them, really. I don't even know why I buy them, but I have them. This one can't be seen yet, but it will. I'm going to wear it every day, are you?
Amen.
Amen. So, despite the fact that we're in a year of favor, we know there's going to be a battle. We know there's going to be a struggle. And for some, there are still some pretty oppressive things that are going on. So, still, the enemy's coming at us. And so, some of you are facing loss. I met a gentleman coming in. He's lost his apartment, a place to live. We know. My husband, Pastor Charles, and I, we know people who have been evicted from their apartments. Some have lost homes, children, a lot of losses. Some have lost different things, maybe lost purity, maybe lost integrity, Maybe you lost vision or passion. And it's a battle because we don't want to be in that place. But it happens. Some are just facing big life decisions, or maybe we just lost our direction. Sometimes I went through a season for several years where I just felt so off purpose. I don't know how many years of a marriage I'd say to my husband, I just feel so off purpose. Next thing you know, I'm saying, I'm off purpose. Amen. Declaring that I'm off purpose. All right? So we don't want to do those patterns anymore. All right? So what I want to do is, I was reading in 1 Samuel chapter 30, and it's a story. I'll tell you about this. Let me tell you the background first. We know that Saul pursued David, and David went to Gath, which was in the land of the Philistines, to hide out. And he hid out there for a while. He even, he and his 600 men even joined the Philistine army against their enemies, earned the graces of at least one man there. And to the point that when the Philistines were going to go up against the Israelites, the one man who he gained great favor with thought that David and his 600 men should join in the battle against the Israelites. Well, God changed that plan. You know, the bottom line is he and his men were rescued from having to fight against the Israelites because it wasn't trust by all of the Philistines. So that's the background. So David and his 600 men go home to Ziklag, which was given to him as a city because he had earned the favor and grace of the Philistines. So that was their city. He and those 600 men went home to find no wives, no children. Everything they had owned was burned to the ground. They had nothing. From what they could see from the earthly perspective, they had not one thing or one person as a part of their life or in their possession except the baggage that came with them back to a burned down city. Don't you know that was a bad place to be in? Don't you know that that was a really tough place to be in? I don't know how more desperate you could feel. So let's look at David's responses throughout this chapter, because they give us some keys, and they're not new, but I think they need to be re-emphasized in the midst of favor. This was not a time of favor for David. It was not that you could see favor, but this was one step in his journey to becoming the king. So whatever we're going through this year in the midst of favor, we know that it's a step in the journey to all that God has promised is our destiny. I don't know what that was, but we're still safe, amen? All right, so it was a step. So what we go through this year, let's not assume that it's always the enemy, first and foremost. Sometimes it is. A lot of times it is. We need to remember that in this time of favor, God needs to see if we're ready for this kind of favor, if we're ready for this kind of ability, if we're ready for these kind of weapons. Do we know how to use them? Are we ready to be that kind of a weapon? So first thing we're going to do is ask God, is this the enemy or is this something you're putting me through? And what's the purpose and what's the reason? Because I sure will line up and I'm going to wear this coat. Amen? Amen. So let's read what David did. So they came to the city, it was burned with fire, nobody was there, they were all taken captive. Verse 4 says, then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voice and they wept. And they wept until they had no more power. They wept until they had no more strength to even weep. That's a lot of weeping and a lot of pain. They wept so much that as the story goes on, it says that when they finally went to pursue and get back everything that belonged to them, that only 400 of the 600 men could go because 200 of them were still too weak to even stand up and go war to get their families back. That's how much they poured out to God in what they did. So that's step number one. I think that this is a year where we need to stop hiding our vulnerable places. We need to be open and vulnerable with God. Share everything with him. You read the Psalms, and David fussed and complained at times. He did. And sometimes we put that coat on, and what comes out of our mouth is not the truth. It's not the truth of here, where we are, what we're going through. We need to be open and honest with God, and we need to learn to be open and honest with each other. There is still so much mistrust in the church. We've got to break that. Yeah. Amen? But it means we've got to become trustworthy people. We got to be people who can hold a confidence. We need to be people we can trust so we can hold each other accountable. Let this be the year that there is no one thing that will stand in the way of our standing side by side, covering each other's backs and sides and fronts in every which way. Amen? So let this be the year, because if we do not, I actually in the last week have had at least three recently who have talked to me about circumstances in their lives and said different words basically to say, but I'm acting as if nothing's wrong. What does that lead to? Bitterness, frustration, anger. When we're vulnerable and we will share where we are, then we find that place of healing. So I'm gonna say about that. So we have got to stop pretending to be somebody or something or in some place that we're not. Amen? These men did not hide the fact that they were as broken as they could possibly be, to the point they couldn't even fight for what was theirs. Amen? So we need to confess our own struggles to each other with a safe person. And in doing so, I believe that because there's so much favor and so much in heaven that's being poured out, that as we do that, then light will come upon the strategies of the enemy as we talk about it. And we'll know what it is we're fighting against, and we'll know how to fight, and we'll know how to win, because the word says this is a year of victory as well, amen? That those things we fought for so long that we have just battled over and battled over and battled over and battled over, that this year it's done, amen? So that's one key that David and his men had, amen? It says then that verse 6 says that David was greatly distressed. Of course he was. David was greatly distressed because the people talked about stoning him, because he took them away from their families and they were gone, the places. They talked about stoning him. They were grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. So he had the same loss they have, and now in addition to that, the men wanted to stone him. So we see two responses to this situation. One was David's, which we're going to talk about, and one were these men. One was the response of these men. And their response was to talk about the circumstances, not address the circumstances, but talk about them, find some place to put blame, and then talk about killing him as if that were going to change anything. Kill the very man who could lead them into getting back everything that had been taken. But that's what happens when we focus on the circumstances. I believe that one of the things we can get this year, truly get, is God's perspective and God's vision. We won't see from Pat Fraley's eyes. I believe that when things come against Charles and me or our family, that we will be able to see God's perspective, and we don't have to mouth and say, who's to blame for this? Whose fault is this? You know, we won't talk about the circumstances. We will address the circumstances, go to war against them, and we will win. Amen. And so will you, because God said so. Amen? What an awesome year in the Lord. So the next thing that David did was... That was the response, but the second thing David did was, it says that David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Yes. Amen? He didn't look at those people and start fussing and saying, at least, you know, they're going to stone me. Well, you know, I'm in this just as deep as they are. I've lost just as much. Why are they going to stone me? It says he encouraged himself in the Lord. So what does that mean for you and me? Doesn't give a word about how he encouraged himself in the Lord. We can read through the Psalms and get some good ideas about how we did this at times, but you shout out some to me. How would you encourage yourself in the Lord? In the midst of horrible circumstances, maybe really tough ones, how would you do that? Whew, I heard or. All right, somebody yell louder than somebody else.
Praise him.
Praise him. All right, praise him. What else would you do to encourage yourself in the Lord?
Pray in tongues.
Pray in tongues, amen. What else would you do to encourage yourself in the Lord?
Remind
yourselves of things he's done in the past. Amen. What else would you do?
Read
your prophetic word. We go back and we read the written word and our prophetic word, and we remind ourselves of who God is now, what he's done for us in the past. And by the written word, we know what he'll do for us in the future, and we declare those things. So we talk a lot in this house about declarations and decrees, but I mean to tell you, this year you need to do it.
Yes.
Amen? We cannot let ourselves speak words that should not be said.
That's right.
Because when we do, we speak word curses upon our very destiny. You know, that window in heaven that's open, you know, that open heaven, the window starts to look a little smaller. Amen? And truthfully, it can become a little bit smaller. We can't access it through sin. And when we get into fear and we start speaking discouragement and speaking this and speaking that, the bottom line is it's not encouraging to ourselves or anybody else, but it's also sin. You know, sometimes we don't want to say that, but it really is. Amen? So this year, let this be the year we declare, really not talk about it. Let's do it. Amen? Because that is a key. We remind ourselves of all of that. So basically what we're doing is we're speaking truth into some deceptive situation, some situation that's horrible at very best. Whatever your struggle happens to be, what's the truth of what God would have to say about that situation? And what's the truth about what God would have to say about you, Cooper? I just met Cooper tonight. Amen. Sometimes we can have people speaking words about us, and it gets us down and discouraged. And we have to remind ourselves of who we are in Christ and who Jesus is inside of us. Remember our identity and speak our prophetic words, as was said over here in that dark corner that I can't see. I know there are people over there because I can see colors, but that's about it. So anyway, but one thing is true. I mean, before we start this little thing of declaring and decreeing and praying in tongues and doing all those things we know to do, these are not new. One thing we need to remember this year, 1 Peter 5 says, resist steadfast in the faith. So we need to get ourselves in a position to be able to do the things we're talking about before we can really do them. Because we do feel things like frustration and bitterness and anger and discouragement and discontent, sadness, whatever those things happen to be. So we have to make up a decision. Just make a decision and back it up by prayer. Pray ourselves through it sometimes. Make a decision that we will not succumb to those feelings. Because as this house often says, feelings are not facts. I don't care how down and out you feel right now. That's not your portion. We need to do what the Bible tells us to do and what we have talked about for years in this house. We need to rise up. Amen. Can't you just feel it in the midst of whatever you're feeling right now? We need to rise up. We're not going to stay in that place. Amen. All right, so that's the second thing he did. He then called a priest, according to verse 7. Now, we don't need to call a priest because we are priests.
That's right.
Amen? So what that says to me is somebody said worship. When we call a priest, that puts us in our priestly mode. In our priestly mode, we worship the Lord.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Worship is a weapon of warfare.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Totally disarms the enemy.
Yes.
So worship. That's what David did. I believe that when he called the priest, doesn't talk about all that happened between him and the priest. But given the priest's role, it's hard to believe that there wasn't some kind of worship. And David had a worshipful heart. But again, the word doesn't say anything about it. But I know in my priestly role, what I would do is worship. Amen. Worship the God. And thank him. And this is a place where we don't just worship, but we give thanks for something we have not yet seen happen. Amen. We haven't seen the victory. We don't have that apartment yet. We don't have transportation yet. But we thank God that that apartment is coming, that it will be nicer than the last one we had. We thank you, God, that that vehicle is coming. We thank you, God, that what you said about me is true, and I will operate in what you put inside of me. I will be someone who can change the atmosphere. I will be someone who has a bigger footprint in my life than I have ever had before. I will be someone who can speak a word of encouragement to someone on the street, and they'll come to the Lord, be filled with the Holy Spirit, and start walking in the power right away. Amen? I will be that weapon. So thank you, Lord, that I will be those things. Or thank you, Lord, that situation, whatever it is removed from me already. So we worship and we give thanks for that which we have not yet seen. Amen? Amen. So after he called the priests, he inquired the Lord as to what to do. And what he was told to do was that he was to pursue the enemy, that they would overtake the enemy, they were to get everything back. That was the bottom line. So the next thing that he did, so far they've been vulnerable, right? They encouraged himself in the Lord. He called a priest. He inquired the Lord as to what to do, according to verse 8. And in verse 9 says, David went and he pursued. So he moved on the word. He did something. He didn't stay stuck like some of those men did, although they followed him. All right? And because he took action on what God required of him or instructions that God gave him, God intervened, just like in Esther. The story of Esther doesn't say God ever did anything. It doesn't say that God caused them to come upon a man who could lead them to where the Amalekites were, the men who had burned their town. It doesn't say that. But I believe that because he was faithful to follow the word, God intervened behind the scenes. And they came upon a man who could lead them to where everything that had been stolen was. Amen? I believe this year, as we act upon what God has required of us to do, asked us to do, anointed us to do, that the favor will show by intervention in circumstances in our lives so that we may not even have to battle for them. God may take care of them and will this year some of those circumstances, just like Jehoshaphat, who seemed to be in an impossible situation, surrounded by the enemy, no way out. He took a little different strategy, which is what some of you shouted out. He didn't know what to do, so he prayed and he fasted, but not by himself. He called every man, woman, and child, and they stood, and they fasted, and they prayed. And out of that, a prophetic word came about what to do and what the strategy was. Jehoshaphat did it, didn't even have to go to battle. He just sent the priests out first, the singers out first. And the enemy heard the noise and thought, ooh, what a mighty army we have here, and they retreated on their own. This year, if we will walk out what God has said for us to walk out, I truly believe in my heart of hearts that some of our battles will be won by God himself while we're just doing what we're doing, wearing our coat, and the light shining on us, and we're operating in our gifts, and we're feeding the poor, and we're going downtown doing power evangelism. We're doing what God has imparted us to do, and he's behind the scenes doing what he needs to do to make sure we can keep rolling. Amen? Yeah. Amen. So verse 9, that was verse 9. So in the context of that, though, I want to talk about some things, you know, because we're not always in that kind of war where we're going to go up and pick up our weapons and go out. Sometimes we just keep rolling. The hardest ones are when people come against us. Every day people come against us. So one of the doing strategies I think is important this year, and I know some people who are operating in this right now, and my husband happens to be one of them, is that we move in the opposite spirit.
Yes.
You know, Matthew 5:43 says to love our enemies. Love them, bless them, do good for them, pray for them. So if someone come against you with an unkind spirit, our response is going to be to return with a kind spirit. Amen. If someone speaks always deceptive words, we're going to come at them with honesty. Amen. Someone lies left and right, we're going to come forth with truth. Someone whose heart is closed and you just can't get in there even to help them, we're going to come to them with open hearts, receptive hearts, being accessible, so that our opposite spirit will destroy the spirits of unkindness, of unopenness or unvulnerability. So this is a place where sometimes that's all we're required to do, because there's no huge, awesome battle. We're not losing a house, a car, or a job, or kids, nothing. We're just having a day-to-day struggle with people. Amen? So our response is going to be the opposite spirit. I think that is a true strategy this year. We have heard that generosity is. Amen? So I really believe that that is a strategy. And what it does is it keeps our mouths shut from saying negative things. You know, if we're operating in the opposite spirit,
it was me.
I'm excited about this man, too. But it's okay, because he's my husband. Amen. We are back on. Amen. So we've said we're going to respond with the opposite spirit. One of the last things that David did was, if you go through the rest of the story from verse 21 to the end, you know, first of all, it tells you they didn't just get back what was theirs, but they got spoils as well.
Amen.
Amen, yeah. So when David got back to Ziklag, those 200 men, you know, they came out and met them, and probably met their families and David. And it's interesting, again, the response of the other men. They went forth to meet David, met the people, came near. Verse 22 says, then answered all the wicked men. God called them wicked men. Wicked men for this. Answered all the wicked men and worthless fellows of those who went with David and said, because they were not with us, we're not going to give them anything. Because basically they stayed here by the bags. They didn't come fight. They didn't work for this booty. So we're not going to give them any spoils or any booty. Amen? That's what they said. You didn't work for it, you don't get it. What kind of a spirit is that? You get your children and your stuff back, but that's it. That's what they said in everyday modern English. But what David said was, you will not do so, my brethren, with that which the Lord has given us. So David remembered who was responsible for what they got back. Always had his eyes kept on the Lord, which is why he could encourage himself. Didn't look at the circumstances or, oh gosh, I work a whole lot harder in this church than some other people do. I wonder why they get to have the platform. I wonder why they get to do such and such. It's kind of what it boils down to today. I'm working on my job, I'm doing a lot more, so-and-so gets the credit. Those are earthly circumstances. It's kind of a so what. We need to get to that place. So what if they get the earthly credit?
That's right.
What we care about is how God sees us.
Yes.
Amen. God is the one who gives us favor.
Yes.
He's the one who gives us more than what we already have, the booty and the spoils.
Yes.
So it tells us what David did. It says, Of course, he shared the spoils with the 200 men that didn't participate in fighting. So he had a spirit of unity. He knew that they were one and everyone had their part. Maybe they did not fight, but maybe those men did not stop to think. That place got raided and destroyed because they were gone. There were at least 200 men guarding what little bit they had left, their baggage. That is, remember, that's all they had in terms of possessions. The very fact that those men were there was a protection against the very last of what they had being taken. So there was a role. And first of all, sometimes God has some people in a place of rest.
Yes.
We have to be okay with that, that they're in a place of rest and we're not. Because God does things in us and in them in that place of rest. And it doesn't mean that in that place of rest that they're worthless fellows.
That's right.
Amen? Yes. They may be in that place of rest, interceding and praying like the rest of us aren't.
Yes.
Covering anything and everything. So we, again, have to look through God's eyes. But what I want to get to in addition is it says, of course, they got their share. It says, when David came to Ziklag, he sent of the spoil unto the elders of Judah. And then it goes on for three verses or so about all the places he sent the booty to. He was very, very generous with what God had given him. He divided the booty. He recognized the contribution of everybody, regardless of how little it seemed to be. He saw value in what everybody did and what they were called to do at that moment. So yeah, we got to see the value in our brothers and sisters. Not look at what they're capable of, what they can do, what they're doing now, but just because they are our brothers and sisters in Christ. Without them, and without them wearing their Joseph coat of many colors, however that expresses itself, and remember, we can all have the same gift. It still has a different expression.
Right.
Amen? However they express it, as long as they are expressing and wearing that coat. And if they're not, what do we do? We pray for them. Give them the courage and the boldness to put that coat on, rise up, and operate and be a weapon that God's called us to be. Amen?
Amen.
So we got to get that out of us too. And this is not new to you. It's not new. But the application this year is critical. Have you heard anything new? No. Really, be honest. That honest spirit. Amen?
Amen?
It's not new. But it is an important application this year and part of the strategy for accessing the favor of God. So he was generous. He had a spirit of unity. Galatians 6:2 says, bear one another's burdens. Amen? So it's a year to bear one another's burdens, to be generous with our time, which means that we need to make time to listen to people.
Yes.
Sometimes, I'll be honest with you, sometimes I'm so worn out when someone wants me to listen. Sometimes it's hard for me. And I'm going to be honest with you. Sometimes I don't want to.
Yeah.
And I have to just, and I stay because it's the right thing to do.
Yes.
You know, and I always feel better after I've been with someone and listened and prayed.
Yes.
Is there anybody out there who's never felt that way? Not one hand, because it's the truth. We've all been there.
Right.
But it doesn't mean we have to take on false responsibilities either.
Right.
All right? No false responsibilities. But we can be generous with our time. Being generous with our money is the easy one. It's easy to write a check. But it's necessary. We can be generous with our possessions. There are so many things that we can do this year to help and support each other during the struggles. And if they're not having struggles, there are so many things we can do to help our brothers and sisters, whatever God has put inside of us, to move forward in their journey toward their breakthrough and their destination that God has for them. Amen? So, we've shouted out everything else that I have on here. So I'm going to stop because I want there to be ministry time. And I want to minister over one particular situation, all of us. And then we're going to minister to each other. All right? And this first one is we're ministering to a brother that's not even in this country. Amen? But there are men and women, children all over the world who are in situations far more difficult than anything I have ever experienced or will ever experience in my lifetime. So before we move on with any activations or anything like that, I want us to minister and declare and decree for Pastor Andrew Brunson.
Yes.
Amen? He's a brother. He's in a difficult situation. Is there anybody here who does not know about the situation? All right, there are several of you. Pastor Andrew Brunson has been a pastor. He's from, one of the Carolinas. It doesn't really matter. One of the Carolinas. And he has been a minister in Izmir, Turkey for decades, for a very, very long time. 18 months ago, he was arrested. And he was placed in a prison and in a cell that was a cell meant for 8 people, and there were 22 in the cell, an average of 22 people. A lot of prayer went out, and by the grace of God, he was moved to a different prison where he was in a cell where he had a cellmate and, you know, kind of got along with him. And no charges were brought until very recently, within the last couple months, I guess it was, but pretty recently. He was charged with Christianization, which equates, apparently, in Turkey right now, to terrorism. All right? So he's a terrorist because he's a Christian. And what we need to remember, Turkey is a member of NATO, an ally of ours, a member of NATO. So this is a country. Charles and I were talking about it tonight. Well, how does this happen? Even in the natural, I think people must be thinking, how does this happen? This country is an ally. So anyway, what happened is on Monday, he went to trial. And by a report of his wife and an email that came out today, his wife said that Andrew testified for hours, did a beautiful job, that it was well done, that lawyers and all those who were supporting also did a really good job. And at the end of the day, they were hoping that he would be released, but he was not. And he was sent back to prison, but the judge sent him back to the first prison, where he was in a cell with probably up to 22 people. And for the first time that I know of and have read of, he broke. He wept. I mean, just the thought of going back to that prison. He wept. He has a wife, Noreen, and children. And prayer went out since Monday until today. And Prophet Catherine called me just before the service to say that he has been moved from that prison to the prison where he was, where he had a cellmate that he at least could get along with. So there's power in what we do here. And this year, we're going to use that power. So I thought about how are we going to do this? I first thought, well, I could have the leaders come up here and we could declare and decree and you all would just agree, but I don't want to do that. I want a lot of declarations going out on his behalf. So what I want us to do is I want us to pair up, all right? I want us to pair up. If you'd stand up and find yourselves a partner. And that is Pastor Andrew Brunson's situation. Is that biblical? Can you not think of some scripture that you can quote over him? Deliverance is not deliverance his portion. Freedom. The word says Jesus died so we could be free. Yes. Amen? I want us to start with the taller of the two, or just go back and forth. Start with one of you. I want us to open with prayer, and I'm going to spend a few minutes with, as each one of you gets a decree or a declaration, I want you to shout it out to each other. I want there to be decrees and declarations for this man's freedom all over this room. If he could be moved from one cell to a different prison in a matter of several days, why can't we get him out?
That's right.
Amen? So let's put our Joseph coat on right now, and let's operate with all the weapons we have inside of us. I don't care if you pray along with it, intercede however you have to. When you hear something from the word, you express it. You declare it, you decree it, and we're going to do this for several minutes. Amen? So let's begin. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Father God, I thank you. Amen. Yes, I thank you in the name of Jesus that Pastor Andrew Brunson is free in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord, for restoration of all that's been taken from him. I thank you, Lord, that he will be with his family again. I thank you, Lord, that he will be brought home to the United States of America. I thank you, Lord God, that there will be an apology on his behalf. I thank you, Lord God, that all that's come against him that has tried to rob his soul and rob his spirit, Lord, that there's healing even in the midst of this. We say, Andrew Brunson, you rise up in the name of Jesus. Rise up as a mighty man of God that you are. You will not be destroyed by this situation. You will not come under this situation. You will rise up with all the strength that God has placed inside of you. There's favor. We place the cloak of favor, Joseph's cloak of favor. Drop that mantle upon him right now, God, in Jesus' name. Let him wear that cloak even in the midst of the prison. Let light shine upon him in a different way in Jesus' name. Let them see something inside of him that brings up a fear that will cause them to do the right thing. Father God, we put a staying hand against the power of the enemy right now in Jesus' name. And those liars, those secret witnesses that came forth, Lord, we break the power of the Lord of their lies right now in Jesus' name. And Father God, render your verdict from the courtrooms of heaven now in Jesus' name. And free this man in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for it, Father, because we can see it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for his freedom in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that in his future, he still will change lives. Thank you, Lord, that salvation still will come through the work you do through him. Thank you, Lord, that his work will not be diminished, but that it will grow under a great spotlight in the name of Jesus, and we thank you for it. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord! Thank you, Lord! Thank you, Lord! Free this man! Thank you, Lord! Hallelujah! Amen. Thank you. Thank you all for doing that. Amen. Amen. Now, you may be seated. Some of you find yourself in a situation where you just feel like you're cornered. You just can't get out. You know, maybe you're just stuck. Anybody in this room feel stuck right now? Several of you. Cooper, you're a worshiper. You are a worshiper. Your worship broke that battle that you're going through right now. You've been asking the Lord for a freedom from something and for an implementation of a desire of your heart, something you believed in your life for a long time that you were to do and that you were to be. Lord says, you've set your sights and your strategies on operating independently out from underneath the rules and the regulations of man, only under what God has to say. There's a business for you, Cooper. There's something independent for you to do that will meet the desires of your heart. And when you worshiped tonight, the way that you worshiped, God moved behind the scenes to go ahead and work on your behalf to meet the number one desire of your heart. Amen? Amen. So some of you feel stuck. You could be stuck in a number of ways. You could be stuck in a job. You could be stuck in advancing forward. You just don't know where to go with what God's given you to do. You could be, first of all, let me say this, you are not stuck in a marriage. This is not about feeling like you're stuck in a marriage. You might feel that way, that is not a fact. We all made a vow before the Lord God, a vow we can honor, that God of the impossible can change any relationship. I don't know why I'm saying that, I hadn't planned to, but somebody out there needs to hear it. All right? So this is not about that. You may feel stuck in advancing in your marriage, but we can break that. So if you feel like you're stuck, you're surrounded, there's no way out, then if we remember the Israelites, after they were delivered, they found themselves ready at the Red Sea with the water in front of them and the Egyptians behind them. Impossible. And Moses prophesied to them that they would be delivered. Wish I had, I actually had a page that had several examples and some things I wanted to do with the scriptures, and I'm sorry that I didn't print that off. But they found themselves boxed in, And Moses prophesied to them. So those of you who feel stuck, I want you to stand. Daryl Spearman, I want you to come up. And I want you to do a very pointed prophetic word for this group who feels stuck. What is God saying about their situation? Now I'm pulling out my team captains. I'm pressing them. I think that's the drums getting us. I don't know what it is, but. All right, Daryl, whatever God gives you for you people who are stuck, but get them to the other side.
My sons and daughters, you've been feeling like you've been stuck and like the enemy's been making way over you, and you've been feeling beat down and destroyed. But know that I've raised up a standard against the enemy, and I'm causing you to begin to rise above your situation, where you begin to see yourself even through the eyes that I've given you, because you'll see that you are more than a conqueror, and that I've given you the tools and the weaponry that you need to be able to defeat every enemy. And joy is about to rise even as you begin to proclaim the word that I've even spoken over you, and what it is I've said about you, and what it is I've said about the situation. For I'm giving you my perspective, and even as you begin to declare my perspective over your situation, you begin to see your enemy become small, and you'll be able to step on your enemy, and the walls that have tried to box you in, they will begin to fall even as you begin to shout. For that shout of victory will destroy the words that have been replaying even over your mind. There, the joy and the praise that will flow out of your mouth will begin to destroy the works of the enemy, even as it's attacked your soul and it seemed like your body and your family was under attack. Begin to declare my goodness over your family. Begin to declare my goodness over your job and even the people that seem to be against you. Begin to declare my blessings over their lives. Begin to bless them that have cursed you, because I will begin to make peace among your enemies, and you will be at peace in your home and in your family. And over that marriage that you felt that was broken and could not be fixed, know that I'm restoring. Even as you begin to pray for your husband, even as you begin to pray for your wife, you'll begin to see them in the way that I created them to be. And there's compassion that will begin to rise over your life, that it'll begin to restore the relationship. And there's even a relationship with a child, like a member of the family, a child. And know that I'm restoring the relationship even with your child, as you begin to bless them and begin to declare who it is that I've said that they are. They will no longer cause you the same amount of grief and pain, but you will have peace and rest in your home.
It's a good thing I said be pointed. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Let me tell you, some of you have been stuck in sin. Put your robe on. Walk in your cloak. You'll be broken. It'll be broken off of you. I saw some of you being released from sin. I saw some of you receiving new vision. I saw new birthings in the area of business. I saw children coming home. I saw restoration of relationships, not just with family, but those who had hurt you in the past, and some who have even abused you verbally, coming up, admitting, apologizing, restoring, and somehow it all gets worked out. It's a God thing, because he's the God of the impossible. Amen. So tonight, the God of the impossible has shown up in the midst of your circumstances. And by the power of the word, what you're stuck in is broken in Jesus' name. Amen. We're a free people. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Prophet Pat. Oh, man, doesn't that feel light?
Yes.
Amen. Praise God. Man, it makes you want to get up and fight. Amen. Praise God. Is everybody with me? I'm the only one feeling like that.